steht William Thompson!
Oh, thank you very much. Give it up for everyone you saw there, Alan and Darren. Thank you very much for coming out. This is lovely. I'll get right into it. I'm ugly as fuck. And I know that. Like, I know the kind of face I have. I'm under no illusions of what I look like. I know what this face is. I look like a staffy that's been turned human by a genie. I know that. I know that, man. And what makes it worse is I've gained a lot of weight this year. That doesn't help how you look, because I've gained a lot of weight. And I know I've gained a lot of weight, because people keep fucking telling me that I've gained a lot of weight. Right? I'll give you an example. I was at a family party a few weeks ago, because my family have a massive party every July. The date's not important. Just know that my pronouns are he/hun. Lovely to be here. Now, I was at this party and I saw my uncle, who I hadn't seen for a while. I went over, went to high-five him, and instead of high-fiving me back, he slapped me on the tit. And I've gotten so fat that one tit flew round and hit the other. Like a big meaty swing ball, right? And I told someone that story, and they had a very 2024 reaction. Because when I told them what had happened, they went, "And were you body conscious the rest of the day? Were you ashamed of your appearance because of what they did?" And I said no, because I don't get body conscious on the 12th of July, right? I don't. Because don't get me wrong, I go to the 12th. It's a big thing for my family. We all go. Some of my Catholic friends are like, "Oh, do you go to the 12th because you hate Irish people?" I say, no, I go to the 12th because for some reason, I'm allowed to do coke on the street. That's why I go. I don't know the history, right? I don't. All I know is some gay Dutch guy punched a king. Now I can have A's for breakfast. That's all I know. And I saw myself on Newtonards Road and I watch them all walk up and down. And as I see them doing their wee walk, my mind doth ponder. The Orange Order, for an organization that loves walking, they love walking. Quite a few fuckers in it, isn't it? Some chubby fuckers in them wee uniforms, man. I'm not slagging them. My uncle's in the Orange Order. He's always like, "Oh, we did a 70-mile walk this weekend, son." I'm like, "You are 5'4" and 38 stone, Davey. What the fuck?" He's like, "Are you slagging the Orange Order?" I'm like, "Maybe if you ordered an orange, you fat bitch, I wouldn't have to. I wouldn't need to." This is the level of intelligence my jokes are going to be, by the way. I'm not a smart comedian. I don't do smart jokes because I'm not a smart person. Never been smart. Even in school, very average student. Some classes, if I enjoyed it, I would do well in. A lot of classes, if I didn't like it, I wouldn't do well in it. The worst class I did was Spanish class. I hated Spanish class because I can't speak a word of Spanish. And our teacher was very passionate about Español. She would insist that anytime you speak in class, you have to do it in Español, por favor. You couldn't even call her miss. You had to call her a señorita for authenticity. Even though her name was as Irish as a fucking car bomb. Anytime I was like, "Miss," she'd be like, "No, no, William. In Español, es señorita." I'm like, "Oh, sorry, señorita. Magookin." That's what I was there. I'm sorry about that. So, couldn't even ask to go to the toilet. If I was like, "Miss, can I use the bathroom?" She'd be like, "No, no, William. In Español, por favor." I'm like, "Well, how do I say I have gambled on a fart and lost?" Because me yamu shot myself. We used to play this game in Spanish where we got a little purple ball and the teacher would throw it. And if you caught it, you would say your name and a fact about yourself in Spanish. And the teacher had picked this up when she was teaching in Madrid. She would always tell us about her Madrid children. She'd be like, "Oh, my Madrid children, they are so good at Espanol." I'm like, "Yes, because they're fucking Spanish." They would catch the ball and be like, me llamo Diego, in studio biblioteca, me gusta. Brought the game to Belfast, did not have the same impact. They were catching the ball going, me llamo Sparky. Me no hablo, me padre. Donde esta Magabre? Then he'd throw the ball, a girl would catch it, and she'd be like, me llamo Demi Lee. In studio, her and beauty. So I grew up in a rough council estate in East Belfast. And a lot of things I talk about in stand-up is to do with my disability, because I have cerebral palsy. And I know my cerebral palsy isn't visible. You wouldn't look at me and immediately go, that guy is disabled, right? Shush. I know. Don't fuck off, right? And that's because I grew up in a rough estate, my mum taught me to hide my disability quite a lot. Because it was hard growing up in a Protestant estate with a disability. I got bullied an awful lot. I wasn't allowed to play football with the other kids. The only reason I'm allowed to help build the bonfire is because I get an extra 10 grand from the council if I'm involved. That's the only reason. So it was hard. So that's why my disability is not visible, because my mom taught me to hide my disability. There's a lot of things that I do subconsciously that hide it so you can't detect it. A lot of it is how to do with how I speak, because as a kid, I had to do speech therapy. That's why I now sound so posh. This is posh for where I'm from. This is, right? I'm posh in Belfast. I go to England, people just hand me change. This is posh. Right, because we all have a posh voice and a rough voice. We all do it, depending on the circumstance. Right now, you're getting my posh voice. This is the voice I use if I'm taking a business call. I don't know what business calls I'm taking. Just I-7 chicken balls in that order, big man, please, yes. Right. I do have a rougher voice. I have a more fucking council estate voice. This is my more smicked out voice. This is the voice I will use if I'm in a taxi and the driver is fucking mental. That's the voice I'll throw on. Just agreeing with him so he doesn't shoot me. Just either. There's too many of them in this country, mate. I agree. But the reason I sound like this is, as a kid, I had to do speech therapy. Now, if you've never done speech therapy, very simple process. You go into a room, the speech therapist will be there, she says a phrase, you repeat it back to her. So I would go into a room, little baby me, I would go in, the speech therapist would be there, she would go, okay, William, repeat after me, how now, brown car? Little baby me would go in, I would do my best, I'd go, how now, a brown car? Thanks for laughing at a wee disabled boy. Trying there, thank you. Fuck me for having dreams, all right. She would go, very good, William. That was very good, no matter what they were laughing at. That was very good. Next one's a little bit harder, so take your time. Nice is nice. I can say that twice. Again, I would go in, I would do my best. I'd go, and nice is nice. I can say that twice. She would go, very good, William, very good. Last one, it is the hardest one, so take your time, last one. That dog is off its leash. I will go and tell the police. That's the hardest one, I would take my time, I would go, the doggy. I'm not a fucking tout. And that was my time. Even the therapist was like, good man, fuck a pig. It's right, good luck. But it worked too well. I now speak too poshly for where I'm from. I get bullied for how posh I speak. I know you're thinking, William, why would you get bullied for that? For learning how to talk properly. Learning to talk as though you don't have cerebral palsy. Why would you get bullied for that? And the answer to that is very simple. If any of you have ever been around Belfast, you will know that everyone sounds like they have cerebral palsy. I go back to my old street and they're like, are you yelled in, you fucking you, you know what I mean, are you, huh? You doing them Paul Cop, your big man Kieran, no, are you doing them? Are some fucking lost me a fair fucking penny, well done. Anyway, tell your dad was asking about him. I'm like, thank you, officer, thank you. can be hard, man. There's a lot of things I do to hide my disability because we're nasty to disabled people in this part of the world. I didn't realize how nasty we were until last year I did some shows in Canada. If you've ever been to Canada, you will know the Canadians are some of the nicest, some of the most empathetic, sympathetic, friendly people that you will ever meet. They'll stop in the street, they'll wave to you, they'll hold open doors. They are lovely. And I knew that when I did the show in Canada. So I decided to have fun with it. I went up to a guy in the front row, sort of where you're sitting. I went, "You there, guess my disability." And because he's a polite little Canadian, he was like, "Oh God, that's a doozy, eh? I'd have to say it, you're just too goddamn handsome." For contrast, I did the same thing in Glasgow. I came out, I went, "Guess my disability." And a man in the front row went, "Down syndrome." So, that's a difference in attitude right there, man. Very different country. Because America has a different attitude towards disability. Some of the things that we say in normal language, Americans don't. And Americans the same. They have language they use every day that is quite offensive to disabled people that we don't say. Like Beyonce got in trouble because of this last year. Because she brought out a song that had a line in it that was seen as ableist. Because the song went, "I want you to spaz on my ass. I want you to spaz, spaz, spaz on my ass, ass, ass." Granted, she didn't do the dance. That's mine. But I got interviewed by a big newspaper because it was a big worldwide story. And they came up to me and they went, "Mr. Thompson, right? Tell me this. With Beyonce says spaz on my ass, is that offensive to you? To you as a spastic, as a disabled man? As a disabled man, how do you feel about that?" I don't like when I get asked questions like that. I am not representative of every disabled person. They all have different opinions. They all are offended by different things. They all have their own individual lines of offense. I cannot speak for all disabled people. All I could do was give my opinion, and my opinion alone. And my opinion was very simple. As a disabled man, I would spaz on Beyonce's ass, no problem. I go full window licker on her tits. I'm not bothering her. It's like, "Come on, big girl, I'll get epileptic on that funny. Let's fucking go." There's a lot of things I do to hide it, mom, because you get in trouble. You get bullied a lot. Another thing my mom used to do when I was a kid to hide my disability would be, because my hand comes up like this, as you can see, that's because of cerebral palsy. It's not because, as the kids in my street used to say, because I'm gay. That's not why I'm doing that. Although it does look massive in that hand, but that's not why I'm doing it. What my mom used to do to teach me to hide my wrist down like that, to hold it down, she would get a shopping bag, right, and just fill it full of tins and cans and make me walk around the street with it tied to my wrist. So no one knew I was disabled. They just thought I fucking loved Asda, right? I remember walking around my street and a guy saw it and he was like, "Excuse me." He was like, "Excuse me. Why is your hand like that? Are you fucking gay or something?" I went, "No, mate, I'm not gay. I'm just disabled." And he went, "Same thing." So that's the environment I grew up in, man. That's why you have to hide it. I always got accused of that as well, because I am very camp as well as a person. I switch between being very camp and very fucking council estate. I can't help it. I was raised by two very different breeds of people. I was raised by a very liberal, very open-minded mother, but I was also raised by a very council estate, get them all out to fuck dad, right? That's why I am a very calm person naturally, but mentally something tells me to knock it back in, be more council estate. Sometimes I can hear my mum's voice going like, "Son, you are amazing. Do whatever you want to do. Don't let anybody get in your way. You're a wee star." And other times I can hear my dad's voice going, "Son, there are people watching. Stop being a fucking fruit, would you?" Because he was very homophobic, my father. Very homophobic. Hated the idea that I might be gay. Anytime he had friends over and I would come into the room, he would start making homophobic jokes at me. I would come into the room, he'd be like, oh, box to the walls, boys. Box to the walls. Don't bend over near him. He loves it. Box to the walls. I'd be like, Dad, I am 7. So if I can get your mate bent over, he wants bummed. That's not on me. That's teamwork at that point, if anything. And I remember one day I'd had enough of it. I just wasn't in the mood to deal with it. And I came into the room and my dad went off on his usual homophobic tirade. I came in, he was like, oh, here he is. Cock Lesnar, here he is. If you drop a pound, you may kick it home. Don't be bending over near him. And I'd had enough. I just went, do you know what, Dad? Do you know what, Papa? I am gay. And I'm very proud of it. I'll be honest with you guys, I'm not gay. I'm not gay when I'm sober. I'm not. Give me a couple of drinks, I'd wear you like a fucking Apple Watch, but sober. Sober, absolutely not. I just did it to wind up my dad. I thought he would laugh. He didn't. He didn't. He didn't like that. He had a look in his face I'd never seen before. It was a mix of anger, confusion, and disgust. He looked like he wanted to stick his foot up my hole, but he was afraid I'd like it. Like he was going to slap me across the arse, but he was afraid I'd be like, oh, again? Oh. Spank me harder, my actual daddy. Go ahead. But luckily for my dad, man, I'm not gay. I love fannies, man. Love them. Oh, I love a fanny. Oh, I love a fanny. See, if there's a shop around here that sold fanny, I'd be on that motorway every day. The staff would know me by name. I wouldn't even have to order. They'd have it ready for me, sitting waiting. 12 o'clock, that's Willie's fanny. He comes in for it. And I'll come in for it. I'll come in and they'll be like, there's your fanny, Mr. Thompson. I'm like, thank you, Denise. I love these. Thank you. I'm not gay. I love fannies. Unfortunately for my dad, so does my sister. So. Man, I do love fannies, but unfortunately, I'm 28 years old. I'm still single. It's very frustrating. Any other single people in the room? Fuck me, that's so. I'm just waiting on a tumbleweed passing. That's so depressing. Here's why, because I've tried dating. I'm not good at it. I'm really not. Because I enjoy being single. I do. There's certain things as a single guy that I enjoy doing that you can only really do when you're single. Like a wee sext. I like a wee sext. Do you know what I mean? For anyone who doesn't know what a sext, it's sexy text. And it's when you text people and be like, you fucking love it and all, don't you? Like, I'm in work and I'm bricked up, but yeah, like that's what we do, right? And what I enjoy about sexting the most is it highlights to me the difference in attitudes towards sex between men and women, right? Because women like the build-up. If you're sexting a woman, they want to envision themselves there. They want to be in the room. They need to imagine everything you're going to do. But men, we just want to get in, get out. Like if you sext a woman, she will demand, she'll text you like a GCSE English essay. Like her sex will read like, I step out of the shower on a cold morning. The steam is radiating off my body. I step into the bedroom. The sunlight is beating in through the blinds. Reflecting off your 97 United Away kit. We fall into each other's arms, we embrace, and we make love. And she'll send all that to then get the reply of, haha, I'm wanking. That's what we do. But you know, women put more into sex than men do. Women, it's more performative for women because they think that's what men want, right? That's they think, you know, they want to see you like enjoying it. Like I had an argument with a friend before that because he was sleeping with his girlfriend and she was giving it the full, oh yeah, oh right. And I was like, that's not real. That's not a real orgasm. He went, that is the real orgasm. I went, it's not a real orgasm, right? Because a woman's orgasm, it's not, ooh, yeah, ooh, that's amazing, ooh. No, a woman's orgasm, you know, a real orgasm is like, ugh. Shh, don't ruin this for me. Because a woman's orgasm, it's like watching wrestling. Do you know what I mean? Do you know what I mean? Like, I know The Undertaker and Kane aren't brothers, but I'm willing to believe it. I'm willing to be invested in the story. But you have to, you know, I always get ashamed of what I look like during sex. One time someone made fun of my orgasm face and I nearly started crying because she told me that during sex, she said the words, "When you come, you look like a blind man trying to pick up change." I said, "What do you mean?" She went, "I looked up and you were just going, oh, oh, oh." So I'm self-conscious about it now. Very self-conscious. But I tried dating, I tried all the apps, tried Tinder. Didn't have a good experience on Tinder. And believe me, I fucking tried, right? I didn't have a good experience on Tinder. One thing happened, right? It was like 4 a.m. and I was a wee bit drunk. And we all know what drunk Tinder's like. You know, you're like Chelsea in the transfer window. You say yes to everything. There's like, too tall, yes. Beard, yes. That's my da, all right. All right, let's reconnect, all right. And I matched with this girl, and she gave me quite an offensive opening message. Because what she messaged, right, because this girl, how can I describe her? She's quite a strong girl. Like, I don't know if I wanted to go out on a date with her, but if you needed help moving house, absolutely. It's like, do you want to do cocktails? I'd be like, no, but there is a fridge that needs shifted, if you could, right? I know you were thinking, William, you're being very mean to this girl. I'll give you a reason why. She was mean to me first, because her opening message to me was, "Oh my God, are you that funny wee spastic?" Now, I'll be honest to you, as far as chat up lines go, that's not my favorite. I didn't love it. I replied, "Don't call me that." She went, "I've heard other people call you it." I went, "No, they're my friends. And I don't like it when they do it. They're just bigger than me and I can't stop them." Right? And then she went, "You must be a shit comedian if you can't take a joke." And initially, I was very angry. Typed out an angry response. Like, "Listen here, you Shrek-looking bitch." Like, and I deleted it because I decided, no, I should educate her on what that word means. She doesn't know the impact of that word. So what I then decided, let's not hate, let's educate. I got my phone out and I typed this message. I said, "Listen, I understand what you were trying to do was say something that would start the conversation off lightly and we could go from there. You were trying to make me laugh and I appreciate that. But you need to understand the history of that word and what that word really means to someone who's disabled. Because any time in our life as a disabled person that someone has called you a spastic, you're brought back mentally to every negative connotation that has. Anytime you've been told you're not good enough for something, anytime you're told you're not good enough for someone, that's the word they've used. And every time you use that word, you're making us replay that in our heads again and again and again. So please, in the future, just take more care with the words that you use and the impact that it might have. You fat bitch." That's what as I said, that fucking ogre, that's what I said. And it worked. We're going out next Thursday. I'm going to finger over my spastic hand. That wasn't needed, that bit at the end. I didn't need to say that, but I did. It's depressing. I'm 28 years old and I still live at home with my grandparents, man. That's fucking super depressing. Because I moved back home with my grandparents because in my early 20s, I was addicted to cocaine. I know. Oh my God, what am I like? Bold boy, I know, right? I did a lot of drugs in my early 20s. Cocaine was the only one I liked. There's a lot of drugs I did that I didn't enjoy. The drug I hate the most to this day, I can't stand, is ecstasy. Can't stand ecstasy. Because anyone who has taken ecstasy knows that when you take ecstasy, your muscles tighten. And as a man with cerebral palsy, That's not the fucking drug I need, man. Anytime I take ecstasy, everyone else is up singing and dancing like, there's a boy I know, he's the one I really love. I'm in the corner looking like a fucking hashtag, like. I'm having a wonderful evening. But living with your grandparents is very difficult, because I worry, my granddad is, he's in his mid-80s now, and I worry about him a lot, because, you know, he's 85, he's gonna die soon, so I worry about him. And I constantly, I'm like phoning my granny to check in on him, I'm always wondering what he's up to. I'll text him like, hi granda, hope you're okay. He won't reply, but he'll change the theme of the conversation to EA. Love you, granda. Norman has changed the conversation to FIFA World Cup, all right? That's him telling me he loves me in his own way, okay? And I remember one day, I came downstairs about 7 a.m, and my granda was lying on the floor. He had no top on, and he was pale, and he was sweating, and he was shaking. And I went over to him, and I went, granda, are you all right? And he just looked up at me with his eyes sort of dazed, and he just went, I'm dying. I went, what? He goes, phone an ambulance, I'm dying. So I phoned an ambulance. They said they'll be there right away. The whole time I'm just sitting shaking him, hoping that he's fine. And eventually the ambulance comes round. And just as the ambulance appears, my granny turns up as well. And I went, granny, you need to get in here. Granddad's dying. And she looked at me for a second, and then she went, any wonder he's dying. Cunt had 3 bottles of wine last night. He was fucking hungover. He was hungover, and I'm grabbing him like it's the end of Saving Private Ryan. He's like, I'm dying, I need an ambulance. You need a Lucozade and a shite, Norman. Get off me. Get off me, man. I did start doing drugs, though. I don't do drugs anymore, unless you have some. I don't buy them anymore. It's the difference. Yeah. I don't really do them. I stopped doing them after I went to Canada, after the Canadian trip, because you guys may not know this. A lot of drugs are legal in Canada. Like, you can just go into a shop, ask for drugs, they will sell you drugs. Now, it is quite mild drugs, like weed or mushrooms. You can't go in and be like, meth, my good man. I have a christening later and I want to get weird with it. You can't do that. But you can get weed and get mushrooms. And I went into Canada, and I was playing Billy Big Bollocks. I'll admit it, right? Because I smoked a bit at the time. I went, give me the strongest stuff you have. And the woman behind the till went, sir, I have to warn you, what you've requested is extremely potent. I went, listen, right? I have smoked it out of Coke cans in the Craigie Estate, right? I can handle whatever you maple syrup eating bastards are taking. I can handle it, right? I won't lie to you guys, I could not handle it. I want to get a little bit giggly. Instead, I fucking met God, right? I ended up having a panic attack in the middle of this, like, Irish bar in the middle of Canada. I felt like everyone was looking at me, so I need to get out of here. Stood up, went to run away. Accidentally clotheslined a waitress. She hit the ground, drinks went everywhere. And this entire bar started laughing at me. And it was at this moment in time I decided to never do drugs again. Because what I didn't know was there was a Scottish bartender working in the Irish bar who had seen everything. He saw me freak out. He saw me stand up. He saw me go to run away. Saw me spear the waitress. And he saw everybody laughing at me. And as I was on the ground covered in drinks with everyone laughing at me, I just heard this thick Glaswegian accent stand up and go, oh, that's no funny. That wee man has Down syndrome. Ladies and gentlemen, you guys have been fucking awesome. Thank you very much for coming out tonight. Give it up for everyone you saw. Thank you very much. I've been William Thompson. Thank you and good night.